want to admonish us this morning that we have to stand. But the most important thing is to gird up the loins this morning of our mind. We have to be liberated. We have to be separated this morning to stand in holiness this morning, to go in seclusion this morning. We have to have our loins girded. That means our minds must be stayed on him this morning to get that breakthrough. We cannot get the breakthrough unless we are standing, for there are storms all around is raging. On every side there are billows tossing this morning. But having our loins girded means we come to an understanding that we are going to stand whatever the cost is. It's not an easy challenge, but our loins must be girded this morning that we are able to go in seclusion, in separation. For if holiness unto the Lord, we have got to be separated from the things which we come in, the things that are crowding our minds. There is a great battlefield in our minds, saints of God. I can tell you that I have to fight to get a breakthrough, to have my mind focused this morning. For us to focus, it's not going to be an easy challenge. It's a fight this morning. But when we focus and get ourselves together, our loins girded with truth, standing on the word of God, we can have the breakthrough this morning. If we have to attain holiness, which is a separation, get into seclusion with God and a one-to-one with God this morning, we have got to have a made-up mind, because the fight is on and the enemy's tagging us this morning. But to get into the pathway of holiness, Kodash, separate, consecrated, dedicated, it takes a mind that is clear. It takes a mind that desires to focus and be obedient to the word of God. That's how we will get to the next level. We don't want to be going around in a circle, but we want to get to the next level with the determination that we have and focusing on him. The focus is on making the breakthrough. The focus is not on the storm. Storms of every sort will come. Billows will toss on every side. But don't concentrate on the storm. Concentrate on the mighty captain. Concentrate on the one who's going to take us. He's going to take us through the storm. And when he takes us through the storm, we're able to stand because we have our loins girded with truth. We need to walk in truth. Unless we walk in truth, we will be defeated. If our minds are not stayed on him. The last word I got in my vision this morning, I was admonishing a group of young people. And the last word I gave with them was, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Romans 6:23. So we have got to focus, because we are walking into holiness. And if we don't walk into holiness, we are going to get the pay for sin. And the pay is death. The wages of sin is death. I'm admonishing us this morning not to labor for that wages, because we'll end up into an eternity without Christ. If we desire to walk in holiness this morning, we have to come together and make a determination within ourselves that we are going to stand having our loins girded with truth and the breastplate of righteousness. When it comes to God, we need to get into that realm this morning. So it behoves us this morning to remember, as I warned them this morning, the last thing in my vision was, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. I want to gain eternal life. I cannot gain eternal life in my way, having my own idea, having my own desire, but I have to be obedient to the word of God and be submissive to the will of God, not to attain the wages of sin, because I need eternal life. I've got a choice. I know I'm in my right mind. I've got to make the decision to have my loins girded, to stand upright in the righteousness of a holy God and press forward. I admonish everyone this morning under the sound of my voice to focus. It's the focus that is going to bring us into the realm that will take us to another level. We cannot get to another level without a fight. We cannot get to another, for the enemy of our soul don't want us to get to the next level. He want to confuse our mind. And I've always said to the saints of God, is not who is the captain of our mind, for there are so many things come to control this mind, but Jesus Christ is the captain of our mind. So I admonish us this morning, every one of us, let us stand. Let us gird up our loins. Let us be sober, for we are walking into holiness. And remember, without holiness, no one shall see God. Remember, saints of God, the word said the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God, and we are all striving to have the gift of God. When we think, blessed be the name of God, that we have been redeemed this morning. There is nothing impossible with God. All we have to do is surrender. Our will is the problem. There is a fighting within our will. We're fighting. When we want to do good, evil is always presenting itself. And robbers are focusing on the will of God, the plan of God, the purpose of God. Saints of the Most High God, let us focus. Let us continue to stand on the promises of God. God bless you. Hold the fort and be strong. And remember that we are not working for the wages of sin, but we are working to gain eternal life. And it causes a separation. It calls for a separation. Total isolation. We are isolated from the things that will rob us this morning of focusing. The things that is of no value. Our minds become so crowded, and we become so depressed, and we become so cast down. Then he plays with our mind. But remember, saints of the Most High God, and to everyone under the sound of my voice this morning, that the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. God bless you. Stay humble. Live at the feet of Jesus. He'll see you through. God bless you, sister.
As Evangelist said, it's high time to gird up our loins. Gird up our loins. And Sister Lisa came and followed it along to say to gird up is to surround or to tighten up. And come to give you a little further definition. To gird up your loins means to prepare for action, to muster up or gather one's resources in preparing for some impending battle. So when the scripture tells us to gird up our loins, it's a battle cry. It's saying get ready, because the battle is coming. If you're not in the midst of it already, the battle is coming. This is not something that the brethren and the saints of old were saying casually, but having gone through tests and toils and snares, they had an understanding of the fierceness of what was coming. You know, there was an excitement when the saints were coming, and the evangelists and the apostles went to the different churches to admonish and to encourage, but also to warn them, to let them know that yes, you're excited right now because you found this great salvation. There's a joy unspeakable that is full of glory, but gird up your loins because the battle is coming. To gird up means to surround, to wrap up, to make sure that there are no loose ends that you can trip over, to prepare yourself for action. And then a text that Evangelist read, it says, gird up your loins with truth. Gird up your loins with truth. In other words, as Sister Lisa said, and I was said in the Sunday school, surround yourself. Wrap yourself up with truth. For the only way to be prepared for action is to be wrapped up in the word of God. To have the God, that's why the words the psalmist said, thy word have I hid in my heart that I may not sin against thee. Because I know that I'm going into a battle. And I know that we're not wrestling against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against spiritual wickedness in high places. You don't go into a gun battle with a sword or a saber. You don't go into a battle where nuclear weapons are being dropped with a little pistol that you pull out of your side. But you must have the appropriate weapon for the appropriate battle. This battle that we are in, when you enlist and you come and you decide that you're going to be on the Lord's side and you repent of your sins and you are baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and filled with his Holy Spirit, you are enlisting for battle. There are no sidelines. Church, hear me this morning. There are no sidelines in this battle. If you enlisted, you've enlisted to fight. If you've taken on the name of Jesus, you become a prime target for the enemy. So what the Bible is telling us this morning and reminding us again, he said, gird up, prepare for action. If you're going to be a slothful servant, don't bother enter the fight, because he has no pleasure in them that turn back. It is a cry from the heart of God, as we are told, in order to go to the next level. There are demons that we will face. We can't go to the next level without a fight. Even in the natural realm has understood that any time that someone needs to progress to the next level, there must be a test. You can't just walk in the hospital and say that you study nursing and then all of a sudden you're going to start administering medication without having passed a test to be certified and to approve, to have a seal from an authorized body to say, yes, you are authorized to be able to operate in a level. So it is in the natural, so it is in the spiritual. For the Lord must authorize us and say, yes, now you're ready. It's not just for us to go on the street and to do what we think we ought to do. But the Bible says that as many as believed, to them gave he the power. The power. The power to become sons of God. But the becoming of a son of God, there is a requirement. For you don't just become. You notice when he said, to them as many as believed, he gave them the power. In other words, the potential, the opportunity. But in order for someone to become a son of God, one must seize the opportunity and do what is required. Well, what is required? What is required is that we follow the word of God, that we be completely and wholly obedient. And the only way to be obedient is to be in the word, to understand what it is that God is calling us to do. Because the battle is for the mind. We've heard it multiple times. You've been in this house, you know that the battle is for the mind. It's not anything that's new to your mind, but let me take us a little deeper this morning into what exactly this battle is entailing. The mind is the metaphysical desire, will, or spirit that makes up the center of thought, attention, decision, intention, and reason that determines a being's course of action, fueling what and how a being thinks. It's our consciousness, our recollection, our ambition, and our understanding. Everything that we do starts in the mind. And that's why the battle is for the mind, because the enemy knows if he can capture our minds, and sometimes he doesn't even need to capture the mind. All he needs to do is distract the mind, because whatever I'm focused on, the Bible said the desire of the mind is our motivation. So whatever my mind desires, whatever is pleasing to my mind, whatever my mind desires to hone in and focus on, that's what I'm going to be motivated to do. Church, all you have to do is watch a man. People can say whatever they want about themselves, but if you watch a man will always betray himself. For oftentimes we try and put up a face and a mask to make us seem as though we are walking this walk. But if you just watch who a person is, just listen. Just listen. People will always betray themselves. And we betray ourselves too. I know that our minds are not focused on Christ just by the conversations that we have. When we come into the house, and even right after service is done, our mind already switched to something else. So I know that our minds are not stayed on God. We're double-minded because 1 minute, and it's not to say that we don't love the Lord, but it's to say that we are so distracted. So distracted that the minute the word is done and the last prayer has been said, already our mind is somewhere else. And the Lord is calling us and saying, listen, this double-mindedness is not going to cut it. If we want to be a soldier in the army of the Lord, this double-mindedness is not going to cut it. For what we must understand, I'm going to give you some scriptures and you can search them in your own time. What you need to understand is that we can control what comes into our mind. Jeremiah 51 verse 50. We have control of what comes into our mind. We hear it all the time that our mind is a highway. And yes, it is. But just like the patroller that's on the highway to make sure that no one's stopping and blocking up traffic, so do we have control and authority to dictate what we allow to sit in our mind. For it's not sin to have these thoughts running through our mind, but it's when we attend to, we pay attention to, we think on, we meditate, we reflect on the thought, that's when the enemy comes in. Because the thoughts, and that's his whole ploy, is to have the thoughts come in your mind so that we will turn our focus, as Evangelist said, off of Christ and turn it to the thing, the temptation, the thing that is pleasing to us, the thing that is desirable for us. That's why we have to say, yes, I like you, I want you, but you're just not good for me. We have the power and the authority to dictate what we allow in our minds. Too many children of the Most High God have allowed the enemy to take rent in their mind, to take up space. God, church, even in the natural realm, tell me, who would you allow to come into your house and occupy your house and not pay you rent? Even my mother, when I turned a certain age, she said, you know what? I sent you to school. I pay your bills. If you're going to stay in this house, you better fork over the money, because I'm not taking any freeloaders. But yet, we, as becoming children of God, we allow the enemy to take up space in our mind. And we allow him to deposit thoughts of selflessness, of lack of self-worth, lack of self-confidence. Because when the Lord calls us to do something, what's the first thing we say? Oh, I. Don't even get to the can't yet, just I. Already our focus is turned off of the one who commands us to do, and our focus is turned onto ourself. That is devil 101, because pride is seeing ourself. It's not seeing ourself as less, it's seeing less of ourself. So that when the Lord calls us to do something, we have said, yes, Lord. When Samuel heard the voice and he did not yet know that the Lord was calling him, he went to Eli and said, Eli, you call me. Eli says, I didn't call you. So he went back to his room and he came back and said, Eli, yes, I heard you. What can I do? He said, I didn't call you, child. Go back. Then he came a third time. He heard his voice and said, Eli, I know you called me. And then Eli was a little slow on the uptake. Why? Because his mind was not on the things of God. Because had his mind been on the things of God where it should have been, if he wasn't so distracted by his own desires and his own wants, then he would have recognized that this was the Lord calling. But he said, when you go and you hear the voice again, say, yes, Lord, thy servant heareth. Weapon number one to combat the attack of the enemy. When the Lord speaks, say, yes, Lord. Because what the enemy does, when the Lord speaks, the enemy sees that as an opportunity to throw all these distractions and throw all these I can'ts. I don't want to lose this, or I don't want to forgive that, or I'm this and I'm that. And the enemy uses all these opportunities, because the enemy is sitting right at our door, waiting for the opportunity. And so the minute the word comes forth from the Lord to say, go and do, go speak for that sister, go pray, go to such a place and deliver word, I can't do that. The enemy is right there waiting. So weapon number one, when you hear the voice of the Lord speak, say, yes, Lord. Don't even think, because we as human beings, we think too much. And we think ourselves right out of the blessing. Why? Because the mind is the center of our thought. So whatever we think is what we do. So a man thinks, so is he. So weapon number one, when the Lord speaks, say,
yes, Lord.
Point number two, states of being begin in the mind. States of being begin in the mind. Acts chapter 20, verse 19. In other words, as the Bible said, so a man thinks, so is he. So if I think I'm sad, and I think I am busted and disgusted, and I think that I am worthless, and I think that I have nothing to offer, and I think that God cannot possibly use me because of all the things that I've done, and if I think I am a victim of my past, then guess what? I've just spoken into my own life, and I've just validated everything that the enemy said about me. I breathe life, yes, because death and life are in the power of the tongue. And so when pastor, whoever is exhorting the people, is here telling you to say certain things, it's not just because we like to hear the word being repeated. It's because it is a weapon. Weapon number two, speak life into your own situation. Speak life into your own situation. The Bible said his words are spirit and his words are life. Don't reiterate your own words or what you heard from somebody else. Whenever you have those thoughts of sadness or worthlessness or anything that you know is not in the word of God, you go back and you pick up a verse and you find it and you read it and you speak to yourself. You find that verse that says, I am more than a conqueror through him that loves me. I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me. And if you can repeat nothing else, repeat it until you believe it. Because the more you repeat it, the more you speak it and you speak into situation, what you're actually doing is you are converting your mind. You are training your mind to believe what is coming out of your mouth. And even though at first you may not believe it, the more you say it, the more you say it, the more you'll start to believe it. And the more you believe it, the more you will live it. The more you will start acting like a conqueror. The more you start walking like a conqueror, so that even if you fall down, while you're falling, you said, you know what? I'm more than a conqueror. So this state that I'm in right now, this can't be a permanent state. So maybe this is just meant to teach me to get a little stronger, to get a little strength in my calf muscles, and to push me up, and to make sure I get a little more muscle in my arms so I can push myself up. Because if I think it, and I speak it, and I believe it, I will live it. And if I live it, I am it. Norman Vincent Peale capitalized on this. Church, I have to tell you, the Bible says, and I speak this verse all the time, that the children of darkness are wiser in their generation than the children of light. And do you know why they are wiser than the children of light? Because all these principles that we talk about, and Pastor sweats, you know, how many gallons of water up here trying to touch and come, you know, speaks into our spirit on Monday nights. The world takes these principles and they apply them. They apply them religiously, but they apply them for their own gain. They apply them, don't fool yourself. They study. They study to be able to extract and extrapolate. Because if you look at the Bible, just for its sheer longevity, just for the sheer fact that it's been around for centuries and centuries and centuries, and people are still flocking to it, you know that there's something important in this book. So even if you're not looking for Christ, even if you're just looking for something concrete, people flock to the word. Why? Because there are principles, life-saving principles in the word, but yet we in the church, we quote and quote and quote, but we don't live it. We don't live it. We don't apply it. The salvation is in the application of the word. That's why the Bible said that we're not just to be hearers of the word, but doers. Because when you do what the word says, you are taking the power of the word and applying it to our lives. The mind is also subject to change. Habakkuk 1 verse 11 and Acts 28 verse 6. The mind is subject to change. That means if my state of being begins in my mind and my mind is subject to change, then that means my state of being is subject to change. That means how I feel is not a permanent state. Church, we need to learn how to change our vocabulary, because too often we say, oh, I feel this, I feel that. No, no, no. We allow our feelings to dictate what our mind thinks. But as becoming children of God, we need to take our mind and take what we believe and allow that to dictate what we feel, not how we feel, because the enemy loves emotions. Why? Because emotions are sensual, and he loves to come and, you know, play that nice sweet song and cage our emotions, and then come have and insert himself and be able to speak sweet nothings into our ear while we're so distracted. And he loves emotion. Why? Because it's sensual and it's something that he can use. But in the spirit world, there are no emotions. The spirit world is stripped of emotions. All there are is fact and truth. That's it. That's all. Nothing else. You can't entice. You can't fight an enemy with emotion. But all you can fight him with is the truth, which is the word of God. Which is why you must gird your loins up. Gird your life up with truth. So that when the enemy comes and tries to use feelings and emotions and all these different tools to be able to distract you, you can say, it is written. When the enemy came to Jesus in the wilderness, all Jesus said was, it is written. And he used the appropriate tool for the appropriate attack. Church, stop trying to defeat the enemy with your emotionalism. Stop trying to defeat the enemy with yelling and screaming, because yelling and screaming does absolutely nothing. Satan just waits by and waits. Give her 3 more minutes. She'll run it. She's out of shape. Give her 3 more minutes. And the minute we're done, he comes and he attacks. Stop trying to defeat the enemy with emotionalism and sensationalism. The only thing that will defeat the enemy is the word of God. Bind up those feelings, bind up those emotions, and don't let them control you. You have control over what you feel. You have control over what you think. Everyone say, I have control over my own mind. Stop giving the enemy control over your mind and stop allowing the devil to dictate what you think. The mind is subject to change, and the natural mind is often quick to interpret stimuli. Acts chapter 28, verse 6. What does that mean? It means when we hear things, we respond. But we don't necessarily respond according to the word. We respond according to whatever is in our mind at the time. So if our mind is dictating that Sister Jean is looking at me and I really don't think she likes me, then, you know, when she's cutting her eye, I take that as proof to substantiate what is already in my mind. Instead of just going to her and saying, listen, Sister Jean, you know what? You're cutting your eyes at me. Like, is something going on? Dude? You know, just instead of talking and getting to the heart of the matter, our mind interprets. A natural mind interprets stimuli based on what is already in the mind. So depending on what is already in your mind, we find proof and substantiation to back up what we think. And the enemy just feels into that. Be like, yeah, she cut her eyes. You know she doesn't like you. Ever since that time, you can't. And the enemy feeds on that and comes to bring discord. Thank you. Disunity. Thank you. So weapon number four. We're on weapon number four now. Weapon number four. Meditate on the word day and night. For Psalm verse 1 says, he that meditates, who loves the law, meditates on it day and night, and he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water, who brings forth fruit in a season, whose leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. Do you know why whatever he does shall prosper? Because everything he does is in line with the word of God. Do you know why everything he does is in line with the word of God? Because that is all that his mind is thinking about every day and every night. So if you catch him in the shower, he's thinking about the word. If you catch him and you cut him off on the side of the highway, he's thinking about the word. So instead of cursing you, he's going to bless you because he knows that there must be something why you are rushing so fast to get where you're going. And so he's going to bless you on the way. Why? Because he's always thinking about the word. So his center of thought and his desire and his intention is focused on the word. And because it's focused on the word, that's where his desire is. So even though there's that other law that's rising up in his member saying, don't bless, don't do that. You don't have Jesus. You don't have to talk about Jesus all the time. He says, oh yes, I do. It is written, I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praise shall continually be in my mouth. The mind is subject, I'll put these two together. The mind is subject to be poisoned and embittered, and is subject to doubt, anxiety, worry, and unsettledness. Acts chapter 14, verse 2, Luke 12, 29. The mind is subject to be poisoned and embittered. But the poison that is used to inject in the mind is not arsenic and things that will poison the natural body, but it is the words that we hear and that we allow to seep into our spirits. It's a word of doubt that the enemy tries to plant in our spirit when he comes with those fiery darts of the wicked. Well, see, this is why the Bible said in the passage that Evangelist read, this is why we must have the shield of faith, because faith is trust in the word of God. And if you trust in the word of God, then those fiery darts of the wicked will not be able to penetrate. Yes, they may try and stick you in the fifth rib, but if you hold up the shield of faith will absorb the fiery darts and make it of none effect. But if you don't hold up the shield of faith and you doubt and you worry and you don't have your mind girded or wrapped up in the word, then those darts penetrate your mind and we start to worry. We start to fear and we say, oh God, maybe, you know, maybe you could do it for Brother Camilo or for somebody else. But Lord, this situation is too grave. And we limit God in our own lives because we allow the arrow to pierce our minds. But that's why the Bible said, be anxious for nothing, but with all prayer and supplication, make thy request known unto God. You don't need to wail and complain. You go before your Father because you know that he hears the cry of his children and he is faithful to answer. If only we'll go before him, because a lot of us don't have our breakthrough because we didn't ask. He said, ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and it shall be opened unto you. For he that asketh, receiveth. That's a definitive. He that seeketh, findeth. And to him that knocketh, it shall be opened unto him. Oh, thank you, Jesus. The mind, which is also the spirit of what makes up who we are, is subject to becoming hard and prideful or focused on the self. Daniel 5, verse 20. coupled with the next one as well. And also, the mind is subject to apathy and reprobation or to depravity from God. Deuteronomy 28, 65 and Romans 1, verse 28. I'll let you read those passages after. The mirror, forgot to give you weapon number 5. Watch who you hang out with. Watch who you hang out with. Watch who you spend time with. Watch who you allow to speak into your spirit. For no one can hurt you like the people that are closest to you. You know, we have a tendency to let our hair down, so to speak, when we're around those who are closest to us and those who are bosom buddies. We have a tendency to lay our hair down, but when we do, we are allowing ourselves to be vulnerable. And so if we are vulnerable around people who have darts or who are being used by the enemy to distract and to distort the truth, then we are giving them easy access to our minds. Be mindful who you allow to speak into your spirit. Watch all those internet preachers that some of us like to listen to, or the radio preachers, or the roadside prophet that are speaking into our lives. Because a lot of people say they're a prophet, but no, at least not a prophet of God. You know a prophet because what he says comes to pass. So weapon number 5 and 6 go together. Watch who you hang out with. And if someone does speak something into your spirit, don't react. Wait. Wait and watch. Because when the Lord sends a word, he always sends it out of the mouth of 2 or 3 witnesses. So you know if it's from the Lord must come and confirm his word. But so often we preempt God and we go ahead and we get a word and we're like, oh God, I got a word, so I'm going to act in faith and go and do what this word is saying, not realizing that it's a trick of the enemy. So when someone, mind who you allow to speak into your life, but if someone does get access and does speak into your spirit, don't react. Wait. Remember, there's no emotion in the spirit realm. Wait on the Lord and be of good courage, for he shall strengthen thine heart. Wait, I say, on the Lord. He said wait twice. Why? Because it is imperative to wait. Another verse says, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. Their strength will be made new, because there's something when you have to, oh God, I wish I could get it to it this morning. There's something that happens when you have to wait. When you have to wait. And if you don't think waiting is painful, just try doing the plank. Have you ever tried doing the plank? It's when you get down on all fours and you have to hold yourself straight like a board. And then you lift up one arm, and then you lift up the other arm, and then one leg and the other leg. Well, you're supposed to hold it for what, 15, 20 seconds? Depending on who? Or 30, I hear over here. If you ever want to know what it's like to really wait, try doing that exercise. 15 seconds, you're like, oh Jesus. Why? But there's something that's happening while you're doing that. See, you are developing strength. You are developing strength when you're having to be in that position, and you know all you want to do is put your leg down and go and have your breakfast and eat what, you know, whatever's coming out of the kitchen. But you know that there's strength that's being developed when you wait. So it is when we wait on the Lord, because we're so eager to go ahead and say, Lord, I want to do this. This looks so right. I think I should. But the Lord says, wait. Because when we wait on the Lord, then we are exercising our faith muscle. See, to every man is given a measure of faith, but faith can be increased. But in order to have it increased, it must be tested. The trying of your faith, or the exercising of your faith, worketh patience. And patience must have its perfect work so that we can be whole, wanting nothing. But if we do not wait, then our faith is not exercised and not strengthened. And so we end up being weak and flabby Christians, which is not what the Lord is looking for, because you can't go to war and be flabby. The first thing they do when you enter the army is they send you to basic training. So that if you've never learned to run a mile or 2 miles, you certainly will learn, or you fall flat on your face. It's the first thing to do to be able to be strengthened. And a lot of us, when we come into the kingdom, the Lord has placed so many gifts in us, and we're so ready to go and to use them. But the Lord is saying, wait, wait, wait on me, and I will direct your step. But we've got to train our minds to wait. The mind, or the spirit, is subject to becoming hard and prideful, or focused on the self. Daniel 5, verse 20. And the mind, when it gets to this point, is subject to apathy and reprobation or depravity from God. If we don't train our minds, and wrap it up in the word. We are subject or liable to becoming hard and prideful. Because what we need to understand is the mind, the central part of our thought and desire and everything that is us, it's akin or synonymous with our spirit, or what makes us what we are. Not who we are, but what we are, because we are spirit, come from God. And when the spirit separates from this flesh, the spirit will go back to God from whom it came. And then the judgment. And if we are not wrapping up our minds in the truth, then we are subject to becoming hard and prideful and so focused on the self that the Lord is subject to turn our minds over to reprobation and depravity. In other words, what that means, it means to be able to strip us of sense of the mind. See, we're in our right mind when we have control over the mind. But there comes a point if we allow ourselves to be so distracted and so turned off, and when the Lord is telling us, come back, focus, focus on me. When he's telling us and speak to us, if we don't listen and we continue to turn ourselves away and turn a deaf ear to what the word of God is saying, then as Romans 1:28 tells us, he turned them over to a reprobate mind. A reprobate mind can't see reason, can't understand, can't put together two logical thoughts. They can't be able to reason properly because their mind is out of control. Have you ever met someone whose mind is out of control? It's not even worth it to have a conversation because there's so much going in their mind that it's like, it's full of confusion. Full. Crowded to the nth degree. And this is what the word says. If we don't train our minds to stay on the word, this is what we are subject or opening ourselves to. Because God is ultimately in control of all things, but he gives us the ability to control our metaphysical center of thought, which we call free will. We have the opportunity to decide. We have the power, not just the opportunity, but the power to decide. And when we decide to allow our minds to be renewed by the continual transformation, or when we allow ourselves to be continually transformed by the renewal of our minds, as it says in Romans 12, verse 2, then this continual transformation will lead us to what God wants and will agree that what he wants is good, satisfying, and able to succeed. In other words, if you're confused and you don't know what God is calling to you to do, and you don't know what you're supposed to be doing, start with the word. Even if you have to go back to Genesis, start with the word. Because the more that you wrap yourself in the word, and as you take all those weapons, the six weapons that we shared today, if you take those weapons and you wrap and you prepare yourself for action, then the Lord will reveal himself and will reveal what he desires you to do. And what is of the utmost importance is that we be fully convinced in our own mind. Romans 14:5. Because him who endures until the end, the same shall be saved. To be saved, salvation is to be rescued from impending danger. If we continue to wrap our minds and prepare our minds for the battle that not only is to come, but the battle that we're really in the midst of right now. If we take the time to prepare our mind and to wrap it up in truth and to stuff it way down in every part of our being, and we are fully convinced of what the word is saying, then we'll be able to endure until the end. For as Evangelist read in Ephesians chapter 6, he said, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that ye may be able to withstand in the evil day, having done all to stand." Church, gird your mind. It's a battle call. It's a cry from the heart of God who desires not one of us to perish, but all of us to come to repentance. And repentance is not just turning away from our sin, but it's turning away from our wicked ways of thinking and our ways of thinking that God is not able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all we could ever ask or think, including us. Gird up your mind.